Associate Professor Bamidis, she's a professor of medical education informatics and in the lab of medical physics of Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. She has founded and has been leading for a research group, namely in medical education informatics in assistive technologies and cerebral science, in applying and effective neuroscience. In the last 6 years, he has been the coordinator of 5 large European projects. He's been a member of an editorial board and employed by journals and associate editor and editors of GMRI journals. He's the president of the Hellenic Biomedical Technology Society.
Signatures of epileptic patients when they don't exhibit fits. In other words, interictal epileptic signatures from signals that were recorded non-invasively with magnetoencephalograms, and you see one of these at that time. This is a 21-year-old picture of measurements and experiments we were doing at that time in Germany with magnetoencephalography. And even at those days, we wanted to find out how the brain works, how the thought and actions produced, and we were using images like these. We were on top of MRI outlines of the brain and the head. We were trying to figure out the function of the brain as it is measured and depicted by measurements of neuronal sources like magnetoencephalography or even electroencephalography. And you see here, as you progress from left to right, is a sort of a millisecond by millisecond, so to say, representation of what happens in the patient when they hear sounds. It's a notable experiment for those that you know. And this patient down here has a cyst also that was extracted, and therefore we can monitor what's different in pathology when something is happening. And then I also sort of dealt with mechanisms of different regions interacting, something that at that time wasn't called functional connectivity networks, but we called it internally within the group functional networks. And we tried to monitor how different regions interact together. Later on, something like 10 years ago, we had a conference in Cyprus where we discussed why these things are not taken at the practical level. And we sort of set a target for ourselves, taking neuroscience out of the box, basically, trying to find how we can apply neuroscience in everyday life. In fact, one of the arguments was that many of the experiments we were doing in the lab or in the clinics were out of purpose, in fact, out of target, because most of the things that we wanted to measure, they are spoiled, they are destroyed. Once you take the patient out of their homes, out of their daily living environments, and you place them in a hospital, you place them in a lab, you place them in a clinic. So, how can we sort of do neuroscience in the wild, meaning in everyday life, when you don't have control conditions? And this is nowadays, more recently, what is happening with precision medicine. It's an emerging approach for treating diseases or preventing diseases even when taking into account individual variability in genes or environment or lifestyle of each person. I'm not going to discuss anything about genes because I don't have any data and I'm not an expert, but much of this has been given earlier with the talks at the micro level and perhaps at nano level earlier in this conference. I'm going to discuss about individual variabilities and how the environment and lifestyle can interact in practice, and so that we can then tailor medical treatments or interventions to the individual characteristics of the patients so that to be useful altogether. So let me focus on the aging consequences from a macro level now. We know that our abilities decline, and if we take measurements of what we can do, how fast we can think, how fast we can interact, how fluently we can speak, and how crystallized is our intelligence, then we start seeing a definitive decline, which starts even from the age of 30 towards the late ages and third age years. And this happens earlier, as I said. This is a mechanism which is involved in many different things. It's happening because of many different things. One is reduced schedules of brain activity. When we grow older, we do less, for example. Obviously, there is a noise environment, noisy processing. We hear less, we see less, we understand less sometimes because we don't have the stimuli with us. And of course, as it was shown, there is a weakened neuromodulatory control because of the different cell processes or different mechanisms that are involved with neurotransmitters. And of course, there is negative learning. We don't go to schools, we don't learn new things when we grow older. And therefore, these are extra mechanisms that, apart from what's happening usually with age in the purple, that we can perhaps, from a macro level, also change back somehow. And of course, preventive cognitive decline is a matter of much research nowadays, and aging-related cognitive decline is our focus. And one of the models that we are working on is what you see here, is that we can have perhaps cognitive activity and physical activity combined together so that we can induce neuroplasticity in the brain. And the cognitive activity can be in terms of cognitive exercise and physical activity in terms of physical exercise. I'm not showing anything different than what the ancient Greeks have mentioned as nousi gis and somati gi. In other words, we have to keep both brain and body active throughout lifetime to slow down or even to invert cognitive decline. So we thought of using different modes of these trainings so that we can do sort of model and study these mechanisms, etc. So even back in a few years' time, we have started these experimentations and design of different systems. In one of the review articles we did, 5 years ago, we started that as a special issue in the NBR journal. We looked at the neuroscience of active and healthy aging from a macro level, like what's happening at the neurofunctioning level or the imaging level, etc., and what things can be done at that level to provide evidence of anything else that can be actually tried. So in 2008, I was happy enough to receive some funding from the European Commission to try different technical innovations. One of those was involving sensors and activities that elderly could perform with devices like game devices, etc. So that they can do cognitive training and physical training while they are monitored in the environment for falls, etc. with different sensors. This lasted for 3 years, and we sort of tried the technologies we developed to do cognitive and physical training with computers and with internet, game blended to be fun, with different sort of output mechanisms, like with touch screens, with wireless devices that could interact, and we developed protocols that allow the different set of exercises to be utilized in different groups. We tried this in different settings with hundreds of patients in Greece and in Europe, throughout Europe, in daily care centers, in clinics, in people's homes, in individual homes, etc., etc. And that's the protocol that was called, because of the project that was called Long Lasting Memories, or LLM, we call this intervention LLM. So basically I'm going to focus on two parts of this, the cognitive training that was done and the physical training that was done. And the cognitive training was in fact borrowed by a big US study, which when we started it was finishing, and it was a full randomized controlled trial with a software that was developed as a spin-off of the University of San Francisco, and at that time it was called Brain Fitness. So we used that protocol, localized it, we localized it in different languages and societies so that we can use it with us. And we then developed our own physical training software that we called Fit for All, so that we can sort of have a combined effect of these. So let me show you how nowadays this physical training material and program looks like, so that you get an idea. Played either by the body or by the hands. Again, balance exercises. This is with chip technology. Again, balance, fishing boat. The question, of course, is whether elderly people can use these balance exercise. You see how the Kinect is using this balance of the track on the top right, and it drives the whole mechanism. And this is a lab that I'll describe later on, that we facilitate to do these experiments in an ecologically valid way. We call this a living lab. This is what you need. So I'm going back into my presentation. So let's see what we have done, in fact. We first of all tried to look at it from different perspectives. we had, of course, control groups, different control groups, active and passive control groups, and we measured things before and after these sets of combined exercises. 2 months was the duration of the exercise, and we looked at cognition in various modes, combining episodic memory, working memory, and executive function, and we proved in hundreds of patients, or not patients, in fact, they were also healthy individuals, elderly healthy individuals, greater than 65 years, that cognition improves. Obviously, body fitness improves as a fact of the physical exercise that is involved here. But what did we want just that? To find out if body improves and the general feeling of how much we can remember improves? No, we want to check. This is about neuroplasticity, of course, and we wanted to check at the macro level whether our brains become better. Before going to that, I'll just mention what I described earlier. You saw in the video a specific setting, which we call a living lab. We wanted to do neuroscience in the wild. So basically, we were stuck at home within our lab environment that looks like a house. People can come and live there, and they can also we can also monitor them with different sensors, but we can also ask them to do the experiments there as part of their daily living scenario. They can also, of course, take this technology now at home and do it there. But the living lab that we have defined is a very dynamic thing. It consists of ecologically valid spaces for these elderly to support all these interventions. And we discuss issues of open innovation, collaboration, and co-development, basically, with the users themselves. And we have different groups that have come to this lab in the last 3 years that is being operated. I'll report a specific group of practitioners that you see on the top right of this figure later on. I'm coming back to the neuroscience questions, is whether we can do these things and we can measure the effects from a neuroscientific point of view. So we made EEG recordings to those patients before they did the exercise and after they did the exercises. At that time, when we started these measurements in 2009, that was beyond any European project that we had. People thought we were crazy. Nothing is going to be observable. Friends of me told me. And you are crazy to waste so many resources to do something, you know, that looks like noise is noise. You're not going to do anything else because it's so noisy. But we did it. Rather than just amplifying the noise from the measurements, we realized that what we actually do, as I mentioned, one of the mechanisms is, you know, as we grow older, there is a much of a noise in our own bodies. We hear less, we see less, that's because there is a lot of noise. And what you see here is an MRI, and on top of that, with the color, is the brain regions that are denoised in a way. So you see a picture where we have taken the group of subjects that have done the intervention, and the group of subjects that is the control group, and doing all the statistics, we take out pre-post for each group, and then we subtract the two gross groups altogether. There is a region that remains still active here, or sometimes we can see regions that are deactivated or activated, and we tend to believe that this is the macro region that is remaining as a sort of a region because of the denoising that happens because of the due to the physical and cognitive training. This is a more or less on the precuneus level of the brain as a region. So we sort of did a lot of modeling and analysis. I'm not going to go into details of the technical things because it's too late for that, but what we are actually doing as well is to look at the brain networks from graph theories and stuff like that. So we split the brain into different nodes, and as you see here, we can have either a graph that is connecting different nodes together in an undirected matter, or like this, that these all nodes are connected, but first the root is like that. So these are directed graphs. And we want to model whether those measurements can give us any sensible thing. our brain networks reorganize because of this intervention, because of this cognitive and physical training. That's what we wanted to ask. And for that, we have now in our arsenal different characteristics of mathematical characteristics of these networks, like the small bone property, which is quantifying the performance of brain network organization, or something else which is called the mean cluster coefficient, which is estimating the capacity of local information processing, or another attribute which is called the characteristic path length, which estimates the global information flow in the brain, or something else which is called small well brain networks, which can demonstrate large cluster coefficient and can be demonstrated through large cluster coefficient and low characteristic path lengths. And we've done measurements of these different types of subjects, like you see here, an example with healthy, amnestic, mild cognitive impaired subjects, as well as mild demented subjects. And we want to see whether these measurements and network properties correlate with tools that the psychologists use, like the mini mental state and the MoCA examination. And these are some of the graphs that we have produced recently that shows how small word properties really correlate with generic cognitive status as it is measured by these neuropsychological tests. But we also want to monitor how this pathology takes place. And if you take the hubs that are formed by these connected networks in the brain, and you monitor the hubs in the healthy elderly, you compare them with amnestic MCI patients or with mild demented patients, you see that the progression is that there are fewer hubs in the brain of cognitively impaired patients. And this reorganization, perhaps, that takes place sometimes can be monitored in this way. So if you take an amnestic patient and you train them, can you shift them to the left and make them green? That's a question. And if you take an MD, can you just revert this process and go to the middle or even to the green? That would be a huge challenge, and we're working to prove that something like this is actually feasible, not quite there yet. The effects of pathological aging, to summarize some of the findings that we have, is that there is a significant reduction in the functional brain network organization, and one of the parameters that is called mean cluster coefficient is showing these for both pathological groups, the MCIs, I mean, and the MDs. But there are compensatory mechanisms during these transition phases, and there is a lot of hubs that are formed in the frontal and parietal regions to compensate for this loss of the other hubs in the posterior regions, for example. Let me just go into how we measure also and how we display functional connectivity in the organization in these patients. So we took a bunch of patients that are leading the exercise, bottom, and we did the controls, the active controls on the top. These are different frequency bands, and you can see one of the meaningful frequency bands, beta band, which is usually our activity band, that remains significant in the intervention group, but is not significant in the other group, where pure lower frequency bands are significant. Basically, this means that the brain itself, the network deteriorates. And this is much better shown here. If you take the control group and you see the brain networks before and after the, you know, recent period of time, 2 months, and you subtract it, you see nothing. And if you take the intervention group and you subtract networks, you see that there is a reorganization that takes place, and this is, if you measure the different bands, emphasized in the middle frequency band. And this is important. This is another way of showing this, density per bands. Now, one of the questions that we asked in the recent past is whether physical activity can also be beneficial for patients with Parkinson's disease. Because we cannot apply just simply cognitive protocols, cognitive training, that's not the problem, but physical activity, physical symptoms are the ones that are obvious in Parkinson's disease. So we looked at the literature. These are some snapshots of the literature that we found to see whether technologies, in fact, can be utilized in intervening with Parkinson's disease Some of them have already appeared since 2012. Up to 2016, with some conclusions, and we are at the moment measuring all these effect sizes to figure out what's happening in the literature. But at the moment, it seems that physical exercise can be beneficial for people who suffer from Parkinson's disease, but different types of exercise have different influence regarding balance, gait, or motor actions and falls, etc., which are important for Parkinson's patients. And therefore, we want to sort of be able to study all these in detail. So we decided to give it a go. So we used what we had as an arsenal, as a technological arsenal, which we nowadays call it LLM here, the approach for combining cognitive and physical training. At the moment, we have expanded our physical training protocol to have some cognitive aspects. And we had the occasion of two Horizon grants funded by the European Commission. One that is focused on Parkinson's patients, which is called Eye Prognosis, led by my good friend and colleague at the Aristotle University, Leonidas Katsinodiadis, and ANCAP, which is a project that is directed by our colleague in Italy, Giuseppe Conti, and we are partners with Elias Magloyanis in this project. So we give it a go, we gave it a go to see whether we can do something for these patients. So I'm going to show you a video that we have produce. This is ongoing work. So Parkinson is a nightmare, as you can all understand. There are 6.3 million patients around the world and another 20 plus millions in danger. Our question is whether physical improvement can have some role in this. So this is our daily lab. This is one of the patients out of the 15 that are currently in this protocol. These are some assessment exercises we use. And of course we do EEG as well to find out pre and post what happens in their own brain. And this is our living lab now with a patient that is going undertaking the physical training protocol in the presence of a facilitator that is also enriching the guidelines that are also given by the system. And there are, of course, measurements throughout the exercise. This lasts for something like 35 to 40 minutes per session. So we ask them to do it 3 times a week. The Kinect monitors them and not only facilitates the exercise, but it also measures the different body movements, which are also measured by a camera on the top and a camera on the side. These are some endurance exercises. You can see the supporting mechanism that this patient is using, just not to fall down. This is a sort of accuracy exercise at this point, which is very important. Now, the thing that I haven't described at all is that we can use the scores of these games as an extra metric for the improvement or even the diagnostic of these groups. But I'm not going to decline towards that direction in this talk. Camera which we have on top. This is a living lab, in fact, with the patients visiting it every day. We are not only doing this in this lab, we are also doing this in their own association's space, but also this specific patient that you see here is starting in his own home next week. So these are EEG recordings, and I'm just going to stop it here to show the complexity of some of these recordings. As you see, as you might expect, there is a lot of involuntary movements because the protocol is just resting. Just stay there for 5 minutes with your eyes open first, and then with your eyes open, with your eyes closed. And we will want to record the default mode network activity, as we call it. But obviously there is no resting position for some of these subjects. And I was shocked, because I'm not a clinician myself, I'm a physicist and an informatician, and therefore I was shocked to see, as a neuroscience, practicing neuroscientist, in one of our measurements, the subject almost drifting down the chair from the EEG lab. And of course we were monitoring from the outside, because it's a shielded room, and we wanted to, either stop the experiment or let it go, and we let it go. And then we need to clean these data, of course, to produce something sensible. And we do use, of course, all contemporary kinds of tools to clean the data as much as we can, and then make sense of it with other contemporary tools of electromagnetic topography and tomography, and then fuse that with this is a. If I just can just go back 1 second. This is the spectral differences that you see. These are data from just one subject that completed these measurements in the last 3 months. So these are frequency bands. The blue is pre-intervention. The red you see here is the post-intervention. So you see frequency changes already from these subjects as a result of these extensive physical and as well as cognitive training period. So we can look now with the SLORETA software and the different parametric mappings what regions are involved, and we are not going to put a lot of emphasis on this result now because it's just from one simple subject. Fresh out of the analysis machines, increased activity in the fusiform gyrus, which we're trying to explain with different literature and other findings from other experiments and other modalities as well. And I'm just going to share with you what happens in the brain. As you see here now, throughout the brain, in a sagittal view, you will see the different activations being formed as a result of the intervention. So I'm not showing you how many regions are involved when you have a Parkinson patient, but what is different when you measure this subject twice, once before and once after this treatment, after this intervention. So we hope that some of these will lead us into useful results. As I said, we started out of the blue, in fact, the collaboration with the Parkinson Patients Association in Northern Greece. And we want to take this as much further as we can, as we did with the cognitively declined patients. So to conclude, I'd just like to bring back the messages that I started my talk with, that the contemporary neuroscience measurements are actually possible at the macro level. And we now have a powerful set of data and tools to capitalize these benefits. We can align with issues of personalized medicine, but I promise in another occasion to show you how, for instance, results from scores of these games align with the improvements that you see in the brain and the improvements you see in the neuropsychological and the physical tests that we do post-activity. If we combine this with the ecologically valid setting, like the one we built all measurements in their own houses, then we can do all these neuroscience on the wild, basically. And of course, it's going to be difficult because the results are not controlled and the experiments are not controlled, but this is the real thing. So this is our way to touch then upon what is recently been coined and termed as precision medicine. And just to advertise that we have been having a research topic in Frontiers about these aging mechanisms as well. And these are some of the logos to thank the different projects that we have running and the Living Lab, the networks. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Do you have any questions?
somehow improves the cognitive part of and he elevates some symptomatology of the Parkinson's disease patients, etc. With the previous talk, with the previous presentation of Professor Tabernarakis, he mentioned that CA ions are involved in mitophagy. And since we know that muscle uses CA in order to contract, etc., could it be like that the exercise, the muscle exercise, uses CA ions that are not used by the brain, and this somehow shifts the mitophagy balance? Could it be like that?
It could be. I mean, I don't know to answer the specific question about this, but there is a lot of hypotheses that we can test.
And so this is or not.
Yes.
Something reasonable to be tested.
Reasonable to be tested and hypothesized, I would say. But this is the important thing. Our previous two talks. I mean, we can we know which of these actually things that you know can be transferred at the macro level of experiment that we can run to assist the synergistic effects. Association space where we set up the same thing, and one in our lab. And I think that 5 patients are coming to our lab, and another 10 patients are doing it there. And we just started that a few weeks ago. We are asking if the whole experiment with these patients hopefully will be completed by Christmas time. So we are planning to do, for instance, post measurements to see the improvements just before Christmas. And of course, we're going to analyze for a long time. But it's going to be the first sample with such interventions and measurements with so many different measurements. Because we have a battery, of course, of the usual tests, sit up and go, blah, 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 how many seconds they can do the different things, and how much is the cognition. But we can also look at the brain networks, but this takes time. It takes a few weeks of rigorous analysis for each of the subjects.
Did you personalize the exercises?
Not at the moment. We put a challenge in, and the results I showed is from just one subject. When we started that in June, something like that, a few months ago, back, we wondered whether to go for personalizing it and therefore being difficult then to judge what's made the difference. Or keep it as it is. We don't use exactly the same protocol like we used for the demented patients, but it's almost the same. So we just made it a bit shorter so that they don't get tired, because these patients, you know, they do have excitation, muscle excitation, which, you know, tires them out. And so we asked ourselves whether they would be able to use it. So we experimented with 3 of them, and they were quite happy to use it. One of them kept coming to the lab during July and August, when everybody was on holiday, and 3 of my students were there just doing daily facilitation measurements with him. And he's happy. So we let him go. We did the post test just before the 15th of August. And then he went on holidays for a month. So when we asked him how he feel like, he said, I didn't believe that I was going to be so much, you know, improved. So 1 month later, when he came back, I asked him politely, of course, if the consent that you signed, we were not supposed to follow up with you, but would you like not come back and be examined? Because we have now 1.5 months of full activity, then holidays, do daily stuff, and then do the post test again as a follow-up. And they were the same, like the post test. So the benefit remained for the time that he went on holidays. And he's still very happy, and now he came and asked whether he can take it home. So he's actually going to buy everything and use it at his own luxury at home now to do it. And of course, we want to look at different other parameters now. How well do we learn from who is going to facilitate doing, et cetera, et cetera. Other microeconomic or social aspects of this. But it's very important and interesting.
Thank you.
Can you take into account the psychological component if we believe, for
example? If they improve cognitively, psychologically, we measure. And there is some slight improvement, but because they don't have a cognitive deficit to start with, this in a group cannot be significant. But we knew that when we started, when my neurologist told me, you know, the things you're doing for cognitive training are going to be useless for them. These are, you know, as you can see them, they are sort of very nice people, you know, cognitively. I mean, they can interact, etc. They can discuss and chat with you. They care for everything, but they have other problems that might be sort of more, you know, trivial. But you know, for them it's very, very important. But we haven't sort of. I'm not sure that we can are going to see a group effect on the cognitive improvement. It has to be shown, of course. We will know by Christmas.